hear me? Speak up? Okay. I hope it's better. Today's motion was that benevolent dictators should hold democratic elections as they like to ask us in their point of information, but will engage with it anyway. What did Ella tell you? First, she told you that kind of process reduces inefficiency because it makes leaders pander to people's needs. We tell you uniquely why this is important in our second argument when we say, especially when you have multiple factions, they're jockeying for power. Unfortunately, we never hear a response from side opposition on that mechanism. We tell you it's uniquely important because it increases intercultural conflict. More on that later on our practical argument. But let's say, okay, we take the point of information at its highest ground. If this happens, it's now a strong democracy. We don't need either side of the house to really claim that, right? Three things in this debate. First, a quick clarification on what we stand for, then two questions on the principle and practical, and finally, our third argument. So first, let's characterize what the debate looks like because we think there's a gross mischaracterization coming out of opposition. What do they tell you? They tell you white democracies are weak because of low voter turnout. That's not true. Like, the United States has low voter turnout. I don't think it's a weak democracy, right? What are the reasons why a weak democracy is actually weak? We think it is because it is liberal, right? A weak democracy is weak if it doesn't have the institutional capacity to actually increase democratic checks in the long run, right? We also tell you it's weak if it doesn't have state capacity, right? What does weak democracies look like? They look like Burundi, they look like Venezuela today, they look like Serbia in the late 1990s, and if Donald Trump has his way, maybe the United States too, right? That's the clarification that we bring you on our side of the house. Two questions then. First, on the principle. Here's the principle they come to with, the idea of a right to vote. They tell you this is based on a moral claim to autonomy. Our principle directly clashes with this. Why? Because it's built off of the assumption that we have a right to vote. The difference is that our principle recognizes that in states where you have weak democracies, your right to vote is not actually actualized, right? Like, the right to vote, the principle idea, is based on the idea that your expression actually translates into real policy. We give you two different mechanisms why actually, like, weak democracies don't actually allow for that, right? We told you they don't have the capacity and they lack the ability. What were their responses to our principle? All they said is, well, they don't show us what life under a good government looks like. Okay, maybe it looks like people having access to critical government services. Maybe it looks like people actually having their needs met, right? But basically what they tell you is the right to expression is better. Look, at the point where your expression never actualizes into real policy, we would say that the right to vote is an empty principle contingent on practical benefits. So let's talk about the practical question in this round, right? We had an entire argument with three different mechanisms about why our side of the house creates stability. It was not enough for side opposition to literally respond to just the top mechanism and say, well, China killed people under a dictatorial regime. Okay, look, our economic argument is intrinsic to dictatorships. Killing people is not intrinsic to benevolent dictatorships. We think at the point where they're literally hurting people, they stop being benevolent dictatorships. We don't endorse that, right? What is the analysis that we tell you? First, we tell you that authoritarian regimes are far more able to conduct successful economic policy because they're less vulnerable to, like, economic jockeying, more than our other mechanism. Second, they are far more able to give services because they don't lack resources. And third, they are not vulnerable to intercultural conflict. This is one of our most important arguments. What did we tell you here? We tell you, especially in nascent states, you see multiple factions, whether they're cultural, ethnic, or religiously divided, jockeying for limited resources. What does this do? It creates the trade-offs that they themselves told you were present in, like, benevolent dictatorships, right? Like, at the top of opposition one, they tried to say, well, it's impossible to care for everyone. We would say we prefer a world where you have a benevolent, independent dictator taking into account what people need, rather than parties, like, literally dominating each other based on the basis of ethnic or religious superiority. We would say not only does this intensify existing conflicts, but it ripens conditions for revolts. More on that in our third argument. What is their argument here? This is just an idea that in the long term, weak democracies become stronger. Okay, three responses here. First, Francisco Franco is not a benevolent dictatorship. I don't know what side opposition is trying to say here. But second, weak democracies often backslide. Look at the example of Iraq, where you had a democracy that did not actually protect its people. What happened? You saw revolts, you saw violence that literally led to the toppling of this kind of government. Third response here, when you have strong foundations, you create the necessary environment for democratic conditions to ensure the long run, right? Like, you are more likely to adopt democratic policies if the economy is well enough already. What happens if the state isn't well enough? All that happens is more violence, more revolts, and more chances of regime change. Their long-term arguments don't stand, yes.
Stability often means silencing minorities and rival factions. Why is this questionable for short-term stability?
2 points on this. First, silencing of minorities increases in your world where weak democracies are literally just going to be controlled by factions at a time. In Iraq, what did you have? You have the Sunnis controlling the government one cycle, and the Shias controlling the government the next cycle. All you do is you accelerate that kind of silencing of minorities. We tell you benevolent dictators actually care about the people. Like, only your response to that has just been, well, there are trade-offs. No. There are trade-offs on both sides of the house. Your side makes them far worse. Let's talk about our third argument now. It's about totalitarian backsliding. This will clash directly with their ideas, but flag that when it happens, right? Two mechanisms on how totalitarian backsliding exists in the first place. First, when you have a lack of state capacity, where do we make the choices between benevolent dictators and weak democracies? Oftentimes, we think these are nation states that have undergone revolt. Why did they undergo revolution in the first place? Because the state failed to meet the needs of the people or actively went against them. Clearly, this doesn't happen in a benevolent dictatorship because it has increased capacity and increased interest in actually protecting the people, right? So what actually happens? In a world, for example, where you don't have the state actualizing what people want, you're far more likely to be susceptible to regime change. That's what we see in, for example, in Egypt, in Pakistan, when the state government didn't actually support what the people wanted, the military just came in and instituted a military junta or a military dictatorship of their own. Why is this so important? First, an increased likelihood of regime change increases instability and violence just on face, right? But second, it increases the likelihood that a bad government in the future. What is the second mechanism for totalitarian backsliding? It's the lack of checks under their side of the house. When you allow democracies to work counter to people's interests and you allow leaders to centralize power over time, what we see happening is what we saw in Venezuela. You have sham elections and no checks on Nicolas Maduro that have massively increased his power. We don't think this is harmful in a benevolent dictatorship because obviously they're benevolent. So what are the harms? They look like a toad. Their side of the house increases checks. At the point where we think both sides of the house are trying to wind up with a dictator, the only difference is in whether that dictator is benevolent or self-serving and harmful. So on that, what do we see in Serbia, for example, between 1996 to 2000, when it had a weak democracy? Milosevic inaugurated himself as president, denied the opposition party seats, and literally killed thousands of Kosovo Muslims. The only thing that stopped him was a literal invasion and a civil war in that country, right? We don't think benevolent dictators do this. Best, all they do is increase dictatorship. The only question you have now is which side of the house you support. Proposition supports a benevolent dictator. Opposition, all they do is have a dictator that's more likely to silence the voices of minorities, silence the voices of other people, and only intensify violence and conflict in the long run. That's what we're so proud to propose.